Well, welcome to the 12th annual poetry contest here in Northeast Texas. You know, what a miracle. We thank so much Anna Ingram, who's been judging since 2008. I mean, it's really fun. And Professor Jim Swan is here, who's been doing the same thing. Dr. Chuck Hamilton, our faithful judges. We are so thankful for Mount Vernon Methodist Church. Their sewing circle, Santa's, they actually are providing the prize money for today. Which is good because I know a lot of you students are going to use a little something, and besides that, an honor. We really have the only honor students in the country that have to sign a special code, the guarantee of poverty, chastity, and obedience. But I think one good thing about doing this, I think, is in our information age, what is the best way to move around and understand knowledge, basically, but conceptually? And is there any difference between poetry and creative conceptualization? Not really. Another reason why I really like this contest is that I think the biggest question you get throughout your life is, where are you from? Northeast Texas, you know, what does that mean? And of course, we do have some limitations. About 75% of the area high school students are considered economically disadvantaged, according to the federal government. I was thinking just recently, you know, how many corporations have a toehold in our area? And yet really get by without paying really anyone a living wage. 120 years ago, Northeast Texas had a much greater clout. We had a number of governors, a lot of statesmen from this area, which we no longer have, especially with the Permian Basin exploding energy, just amazing out there. Of course, we don't really want to live in Midland or Odessa either, do we? One thing I think, though, that is really amazing is that we're sort of like an island of tranquility and a sea of tranquility. It may be a badge of shame, but we really do not know of a battle, a plague, or a riot that's ever occurred here, and I'm very happy with that list. When we come up Route 4000 and we see the green pastures and the still waters, which we'll be seeing some allusion to today, you know, I just think of Psalm 23 and the fact that we do have this kind of unruffled place where the parking is usually free, the traffic usually light, and the lights usually short. And so I thank God for that, and with that we will also start, and I'd like to introduce our new Associate Vice President, Anna Ingram of Arts and Sciences, and also Title V Director.
Thank you, Dr. Dodson. I'm very honored to be here. As he said, this is our 12th year to judge. And it's always fun and interesting to read your poetry, so I appreciate sharing it with us and allowing us to do that. So I'm here to announce the winners. And so I'm going to start with the second place adult winner, Joe Van Boyd. The poem is Northeast Texas Woman with a Hoe.
I should say by way of introduction that this poem, while not exactly autobiographical, is a family poem, one that I wrote about one of my kin, somebody that I knew all of my life, somebody who was born in the 1800s, and who spent all of her life farming, basically. Agriculture was her vocation. And she was a champion in what she did. And not only was I impressed by her, but the whole community was impressed by her. I heard people singing her praises, throwing the laurels to her all of my life. And one time I sat down and wrote a poem about it. And I knew while doing that that there was already a poem with a similar name, the one called Man to the Hope. And there's a painting based on that poem. So my first thought was, it needs to be somewhat different, but yet everybody's going to think of that when they hear or read mine. Even with the gender difference, I figured it would be maybe some confusion. However, the interesting thing was both the poem and the painting also were products of the 1800s. And I thought, well, maybe a lot of the people today won't even be quite as aware of the poem and the painting as I am. But with that background, I titled my poem, Northeast Texas Woman with a Hope. Her name was Aunt Minna. Her full name was Minnie Fowler Tenney. And she came to Tenney when she married on the Doc Tenney. She was in her 30s and he was in his 40s when they married. They farmed all of their life. Lived just a few doors down the dirt road. So the poem goes like this. Proud Minnie, child of an earlier century, daughter of Frank Fowler and feared of no man, spinster for her first 3 decades, barefoot girl with chubby cheeks of tan. She viewed the world through narrowed brown eyes, topped with straight brown, tightly combed hair, framing a pleasant yet unsmiling countenance. Free of any makeup, no hint of worldly air. At age 30, she said yes to my Uncle Doc Tim, who was himself already in his 4th decade. For the rest of their lives, they tilled the soil, resting a living with mule, Kelly plow, and hoe blade. She bore their children, cooked their meals, and as an equal opportunity wife, many toiled in the fields of cotton, corn, and grain, where the long-handled hoe technique defined her life. Minnie's hoe was always the sharpest. She filed it near to a straight razor's edge. Minnie's blade felt heavy, hard, and accurately. Within the crop row and along the seabed edge, the well-worn hoe handle of Minnie's blade etched hard callus on the tissue of each hand. It was a badge of honor for her pioneer heritage, confirming Minnie's mystical reverence for the land. She walked the rows with brisk precision, expertly thinning seedlings, eliminating grass and weed. Those who tried to match Minnie's furious pace were eventually put to shame and forced to concede. Years passed. Decades came and went. Proud Minnie's pace began to slow. The day finally came when word passed that Aunt Minnie had put up the hoe. But her legacy is unmatched in Tenneytown. Her fame still the toast of church and town hall. Sing this song loud and clear for Proud Minnie Tenney, whose long-handled hoe blade was the fastest and most accurate of all. Thank you.
our first place adult winner is Angela Wiley with her poem, Country Churches.
Tucked in the hidden corners off of blacktop roads, some abandoned and pewless, cracks in the walls, rain leaking through, ghosts like quiet but for the wind-blown leaves, skidding over tracks of mice against sandy floors. Gone. Others are healthy, filled on Sundays with laughter and song, sermons preached to a faithful few, who come because their families came, clinging to blessed vestiges of tradition, sitting in self-assigned pews. There. Small churches line the roads in northeast Texas. Steeples reach like spears into the sky. Leaf-swept lawns where cars park on grass. Aged pavement lead to open doors. The small country church awaits bright Sunday mornings. Alive. Coffee and donuts in the air. People in clean clothes, nice dresses, or in jeans with holes in the knee. Today, it hardly matters, as long as someone arrives to fill a pew present. To sing songs from well-worn hymnals, voices strong, some out of tune, singing the old, old songs, a joyful noise rises through the roofs, spreads into the sky, reaches up, worship. Pastors preach to dwindling crowds, competing with large churches and their rock star appeal. Huge displays overhead overwhelm as preachers perform on stage. Spectators watch the show, glimmering. But in the hidden corners of blacktop roads and farm to market highways, the small country church lives on, attended and tended, secure in the hearts of a few who prefer comfort and tradition, loyalty. They go to hear the word preached. They go to visit relatives and friends. They go to be part of a cycle of life, to keep their corner of the world from being abandoned, remaining a rare remnant to shelter against the loss.
Says, well, I can only pay you $50 a month, but you can live in a karate studio. So So did that for about 3 months. And then I noticed across the street was a Nautilus, a fitness center, so I applied for a job over there. And Jim McIndale was the owner. So I said, kind of job, he said, yeah, you can be a salesman and a trainer. So they were selling lifetime memberships for $250. And then what they wanted us to do as trainers was once they got the money, once they got their $250, they wouldn't have to pay any more after that. And we as trainers were supposed to take each client through what are called negatives. Negatives mean it's a decentric contraction. So we would lift this heavy weight up to them, and they would slowly have to lower it on all the machines. So that 3 days, and it is severe soreness, it causes micro tears and swelling in the muscles. Well, I think Mr. McIndale's plan was he didn't want them to come back because then the gym floor would look empty and then the walk-ins would say, oh, I can work out anytime I want. So I didn't want to take people through that negative because I know it's a song performance, so he found out I wasn't doing that, so he fired me. So I only lasted about 2 months on that job. So I took refuge at the University of North Texas, then it was called North Texas State University. And those of you who go to grad school, maybe take this into account. I didn't have to spend a penny. I was an RA in the dorm, and they were paying $50 a month as well as free room and board. And then a teaching assistant, so I was teaching undergrad classes, and then a research assistant in sports psychology. So I literally made more money at that time in my life to be able to save than I have ever since then, because I wasn't spending a penny. So think about that if you could go to grad school. My next job was at San Jacinto College in Houston, and I turn on the TV in Houston, and who do I see? Jim McIndale, my former boss from Nautilus, throwing $100 bills up in here saying we can save you money. That may ring a bell for some of you who will come back to that later. So I taught in Houston for several years, and I wondered, what would it be like to live in a small town? I heard it's much better, slower, easier lifestyle. So I heard about this job, and was ecstatic when I got this job. And so drove up from Houston and lived in that KOA just north of town in a little Airstream trailer. And this was 1988, January. If any of you were here, anybody alive, if you were here, may remember a huge ice storm. And it lasted, remember that? And I remember it lasted at least a week, right? I mean, we couldn't drive anywhere. And I'm stuck in this trailer thinking, what have I got myself into East Texas? What's the mound? It's supposed to be a burial ground. You know, what's going on? And then the lights come on and everything good happened. And this is the part that Dr. Yawks wanted to hear about. That is, when you plug into your church, your community, faculty, staff, students, then everything came alive. We did crazy things. First of all, the older adult students wanted a workout program in town. So we did a class at the Life Health Center at 6 a.m. We started intercession out there because at that time, I don't remember a traditional intercession, but between fall and spring and summer, we had working out over the break times. We did that. We did an infomercial. Anybody ever hear of 6 second abs? That was us. There were students, faculty, staff, all in that infomercial. We raced across America for diabetes. We did a Guinness World Record to raise money for our spinning program. Just everything can happen here if you plug in to the community. Students are fantastic. My wife was a student here. She actually started her business called Classica. And then 2 years ago, she decided to become a builder. So she built her building called the Classica Building in the middle of Mount Pleasant, and now she's a home builder. So just like Jody Pack, who I think she's the one who came up with the phrase, maybe I'm wrong, tell me if I'm wrong, start here, go anywhere. It's true, because you can. So looking back, for my quick story, what can I be teaching? I would say three things. Number one, you might think I would say sign a contract before driving 1,200 miles to a job. But no, thank God for coming to Texas. You know, just everything that happens in your life, it may be challenging, but it's for a reason. Second, I was fired from that job at Nautilus, and it turned out to be the best thing that ever happened, because I would have never gone back to grad school after undergrad and stayed up. I was through with school, but those first two jobs were so horrible that I sought refuge there, but it turned out to be the best thing I ever did. Third, don't be afraid to reinvent yourself. Look at Jim McIndale. Those of you who recognize that name, he went bankrupt in Dallas with the Nautilus program. But then when he went to Houston, he opened a gallery of furniture, multimillionaire philanthropist, has helped so many people, those of you who were here during Hurricane Harvey, he allowed people to come into his facility and sleep in his bed. So, you know, again, don't be afraid to reinvent yourself. And remember, it takes as long as it takes to reach your goals, no matter what those goals will be. Thank you very much.
Is how we use it and where we say it. So hopefully this will be the start of something. And yes, the day's last cigarette is a Metallica song, Turn the Page. The house creaks from the movements on the wooden floor. Generations upon generations had walked through its creaky old door. Quiet and serene, a man stepped outside the gates at the colony of ants, creeping farther every year through underhanded ways. The colony was lit up by the lights of the city, which only sought to fight off the night's silent tranquility. Men looked through glass with only one thing on their minds, though, dreaming of climbing higher and higher, leading others downtrodden below. The man sighed quietly to himself and sat down on the porch, looking at his own land that may soon be scorched. This old cowboy was the last of his kind to remain. The others around him had been given a price that they did not understand. Boots marked from cement instead of worn grass, jeans pristine instead of worn by time past. A cry called out from a child inside, one who had never had the chance to ride. The child's ancestors had come to this land, seeking the opportunity to make their own brand. Decades upon decades had gone into this work, finally to be torn apart by a single corporate mainspring. Whether the baby was crying for a lifestyle lost to time, no one would ever notice his horrific crime. His small tear slided down his face, mirroring the image of the man outside, whose own life was soon to be erased. A woman was heard singing softly a lullaby, a song that was soon to be lost to time. The old cowboy slowly lit the day's last cigarette and looked around at a world that others would soon forget.
There for us. Now, I realize as I look out at choose to live is quite different from where you have to live. Parts of my life, and I was born in 1940, so put it in perspective. So the first parts of my life, multiple years of that, were spent in the city. What did I see? Cars, trucks, garbage trucks, all kinds of stuff, activity in the streets, buildings everywhere. I lived in Boston in a high rise. You didn't know your neighbors in a high rise. The beauty of being in the country is that people see goodness and kindness in each other. They help one. It's one of the joys of my life here, and how pleasant it is that all of my neighbors, if I have a call for anything at all, will come and help me. So here's my message, and it's going to be very brief, that all of your life, you'll be looking for things that fulfill you. And those fulfillments, for the most part, are going to be in a city. Because that's where the income is. That's many times where the graduate education is. That is where you even meet your spouse many times. And you're going to be locked into an environment that it doesn't remind you of the beauty that God gave us to live in. Because you're going to see all the high rises, all the things that man made. When you begin to focus on all the things that man made, you begin to not see the goodness of what God made. And He made each one of us. That's another joy in this area. I find that people are so different here from anything I'm used to. They're all good people. One of my highlights here was I went to Mount Olive Baptist Church. Now, none of you probably know that Mount Olive Baptist Church is a Catholic church. And the people were so warm, so gentle, and so kind. I hadn't experienced that. And I had lived in Charleston, South Carolina for 7 years, taught at the university there. The separation between races was dramatic. I practiced dentistry in Harlingen, Texas, where 6% of the population was Caucasian. You felt the pressure of the minority. I worked in San Antonio on the university there, and the competition between faculty members was extraordinary. There was no degree of friendship or kindness. Everybody was competing with one another. Here, everybody's